Okay, so first I would like to thank George for organizing this workshop. That was not so easy. Now to introduce the topic of the talk for today, I would like to describe you the final step of the proof of the singular version of the Bogonov decomposition theorem. So in this final step, the setup is as follows. X is a normal complex projective variety with mild singularities, KLT, for instance, and zero canonical class. At this point, we know that there exists an abelian variety, as well as a projective variety X1 with mild singularities as well, and zero augmented irregularity. Moreover, there exists a quasi-itale cover from the product of A and X1 to X, and a decomposition of the tangent sheaf of X1 into a direct sum of subsheaves EI. So the EI are strongly stable sheaves with a trivial determinant, and the most important property is that they define foliations with algebraic leaves. And now what is left, what we have to prove, is that this decomposition induces decomposition of X1, or more precisely, decomposition of quasi-itale cover of X1. And this is some are the subject of the talk today. More generally, the topic of the talk is essentially to investigate when the tangent bundle of complex manifold, we'll see the singular version of it later, so when a tangent bundle of a complex manifold splits as a direct sum of subbundles. So you should have a typical example in mind. This is the case where the universal covering space of X, your complex manifold, splits as a direct product, say the product of Ui, and assume that the fundamental group acts diagonally on this product. Then the canonical decomposition on the product, also on the universal cover, induces a decomposition of the tangent sheaf of X. And the first question is we may ask whether the converse hold, namely, whether a direct sum decomposition of the tangent bundle of X gives rise to a splitting of the universal covering. So at this point, I'm not assuming that these two decompositions are related. Now, let us make an observation, a very easy observation. So suppose now we have two direct summand. So Tx is the sum of E plus G. And suppose that this decomposition induces a splitting of a finite itale cover of X, say Y times Z over X. And suppose that both decomposition are compatible. So that means that the decomposition T sub X induces the canonical decomposition on Y times Z. But then obviously, E and G are foliations, so the E and G are stable under the Lie bracket, and moreover, they have closed leaves. And again, we may ask whether the converse holds. So namely, so this is a vague question, we may ask whether a decomposition of the tangent sheaf of this time a mildly singular, say projective variety, into algebraically integrable foliations gives rise to a splitting of some finite quasi-itale cover. And this is the question we are interested in fact. So let me just say what is known so far about, say, question A. So as I said, maybe let me come back to the question. It is more natural to ask that the decomposition of the tangent sheaf is compatible with the decomposition of the universal cover. Let me come back to the question A. So it is in fact more natural to ask that the decomposition of the tangent sheaf Tx induces the decomposition on the universal cover. So this leads to the following conjecture by Bovill in 2000. So X is a compact keller, not necessarily projective, and you have a decomposition of T sub X in a direct sum of subbundles, and you ask for any finite sum of the EI to be integrable. So this should define foliations. And then the conjecture says that the universal covering space splits as a direct product of the UI in such a way that the tangent decomposition of the decomposition of TX lifts to the canonical decomposition of the product. So this conjecture is known to be true in the following situations. This first, Bourdil in his paper in 2000 proved that the conjecture is true for varieties compact Keller manifold with Keller-Einstein metric, and also for Keller surfaces. So the case of Keller surfaces follows from the classification. Later, Brunella, Pereira, and Touzé in 2006 proved first that the conjecture is true if one of the Dirac summand has a rank 1 and the other one has codimension 1. And this in turn implies that the conjecture is also true when the tangent bundle is a direct sum of line bundles. So I proved a similar result for projective varieties before, but the most general case is the following one. And finally, in 2007, Ehring proved that the conjecture is also true when X is now projective and rationally connected. Now, what about question B, the one we are more interested in? Let me just come back to question B. So recall that we ask whether a decomposition into algebraically integrable foliations gives rise to a splitting on some finite cover. So let me pose a conjecture, maybe wrong, I don't know. The conjecture is as follows. So X is a projective variety. Probably we have to assume something of the singularities. And now T sub X decomposes as the direct sum of E plus G. And E and G are both mildly singular foliations and algebraically integrable. Then there should exist a quasi-ethyl cover of X1 of X that decomposes into a aberration map into a product of Y times Z, so that the decomposition of TX lifts to the canonical decomposition of Y times Z. So the main difference between the question and the conjecture is that there is this birational map here. It's not clear to me that this should be an isomorphism. I think this should be the case if the variety is minimal, but in general, I don't think so. And I also believe that this is probably true. I mean, I think I can prove this. For instance, if X is KLT, and if we assume that E and G have canonical singularities. But this is another story. So today, the main theorem I want to discuss is, in fact, in some sense, a stronger version of the conjecture, but in some very special case, for sure. And the statement is as follows. So you start with a normal projective variety with KLT singularities and foliation G with algebraic leaves again, and canonical singularities. You also assume that the canonical class is zero. Okay, so this is the strong assumption in the story. Then there exist complex projective varieties Y and Z with mild singularities again, and a quasi-ethyl cover from Y times Z to X, such that if you pull back your foliation, now it is induced by just a projection Y times Z over Y. So your foliation, just the one foliation, induces a splitting of the variety. So let just me say a few words about the names here. So in fact, I proved a special case of this theorem in 2017. Then Loret, Pereira, and Touzé proved the full theorem when X is smooth. And finally, I proved the singular version later after. Okay, so since I will discuss the proof of this theorem later on. Let me just give you, a few words about, I've not said this, but there is an assumption on the singularities of the foliation. So I don't want to define precisely what canonical singularities are. This is a notion of singularities that comes from the minimal model program. So this is similar to the usual one, say, and this was introduced by McQuillan. Let me just give you a few examples. For instance, if you consider the case of foliation induced by your product, by the projection of onto some factors, so from y times z to y, then g is canonical if and only if z, the fiber, has canonical singularities. So in particular, if you require g to have canonical singularities, this does not say anything on the singularities of the total space. Let me give you another example in dimension 2. This is an important for the SQL. So say work on C2 or a germ of a smooth surface, and you can consider the foliation given by XY equal to some constant. And this is canonical singularities. But if you look at the pencil of lines passing through the origin, this is not canonical singularities. And what you should remember is something that it is true. If you consider a smooth surface and a foliation of rank 1, at the singular point, there are finitely many, in fact, two, finitely many separatrices through the singular point. So a separatrix is just a germ of complex curve that is invariant under the foliation. There's only finitely many. So this is not a characterization of the canonical singularities, but this is a good picture to have in mind. And now finally, let me just state a theorem due to, again, Loré, Pereira, and Touzé, that gives you a characterization of canonical singularities under the assumption that the canonical class here is zero, so the case we are interested in. And in fact, having canonical singularities is equivalent to not to be uniruled. So a foliation is said to be uniruled if, through a general point, there is a rational curve that is tangent to your foliation. So this is a geometric characterization of this class of singularities. Okay, so now I want to I would like to discuss the proof of the main theorem. But before, I have to introduce a notion of regularity. Before, just two applications. So the first one is the obvious one in some sense. As I said in the beginning of the talk, I mean, this completes the proof of the Bogomolov's decomposition theorem in the singular case. This is exactly what we were asking for, okay? And the second one is an application to the study of foliations with zero canonical class, and again, mild singularities, but without the assumption that the leaves are algebraic. So what you can prove using the main theorem is that you can reduce the study of these foliations to foliations that are, let's say, purely transcendental in the sense that all the leaves are purely transcendental. There is no positive dimensional algebraic subvariety tangent to your foliations. So what we have to remember is that you can split the algebraic part from the variety. Okay, so this is another application to the main theory. Okay, so now, as I said before, going to the proof of the main theorem, I want to introduce a notion of regularity. So there are many notions of regularity in a singular case. It's not clear what should be the good notion. But the usual notions are too strong to allow for application in birational geometry. And I propose the following one. So start with a foliation of rank R, normal complex positive variety. So you have the inclusion of your tangent sheaf of the foliation into Tx. Take the wedge product, half wedge product. You dualize, and you end up with a map here from the sheaf of reflexive forms, for R reflexive forms, twisted by O of minus K into Ox. And now say that the foliation is weakly regular if the above map is surjective. Okay, so the first remark, it's easy to see that if X is smooth, G is weakly regular if and only if it is regular in the usual sense. So this is a generalization of the notion of regularity. Let me give you another example. Easy to check that if you have a foliation induced by a projection, then this is always weakly regular. Okay, and in particular, weak regularity does not imply anything on the singularity of the data space. Now, it turns out that it is possible to classify weakly regular rank one foundation on KLT singularities of surfaces. So it is well known that the KLT singularity in dimension two is a quotient singularity. And one can prove that if you have a foliation by curves that is weakly regular, then your total space is just a quotient of C2 by a cyclic group. And the foliation on C2 induced by G, in fact, is a regular foliation. And your action is diagonal with respect to this decomposition. So you have a very nice picture. Let me just quote some very important property that we can check in general for weakly regular foliations on varieties with quotient singularities. The property is that through any point, there is exactly one separatrix. Yeah, okay, just one separatrix through any point. In particular, if you have two germs of separatrix intersecting, this cannot be a weakly regular foliation. We will use this fact later on. Okay, this is the notion of weak regularity. So remember that maybe I should go back to the statement of the theorem. So we start with an algebraically integrable foliation with canonical singularities, and what we are going to prove is that assuming the canonical class is zero, in fact, this foliation is necessarily weakly regular. And for this, we need a criterion. And the criterion is as follows. So before giving the criterion, let me just recall you some adjunction formula. So this is very similar to the adjunction formula. So you start with a foliation of rank R on, again, a normal complex, not necessarily projective, but in the SQL, it will be projective. There is an important assumption, the canonical should be Cartier. And then you consider the variety, which is the closure of an algebraic leaf. Okay, so you assume that this variety is not contained in a singular loci of X, nor G, not entirely contained in a singular loci of X and G. Now, remember that you have this map here, the one we consider to define a weak regularity. And let F be the normalization of L, just to be safe. It turns out that this map induces a canonical map from the canonical class of F to the canonical class of G, restricted to your leaf. So this has to be seen as an adjunction formula. So you relate the canonical class of a leaf to the canonical class of the ambient foliation. Okay, this will be important for the criterion. Now the criterion is as follows. So again, assume that the canonical class is numerically trivial, and suppose in addition a few things, that F has rational singularities, and that the map here, the adjunction map, is an isomorphism. Then it turns out that I can prove that in fact there is a decomposition of Tx to a direct decomposition G plus E. So G has a direct summon. E is also an evolutive subsheaf. And this immediately implies that G is in fact weakly regular. Okay, so this I have to say that this criterion in fact goes back to, again, Loret, Pereira, and Touzet in the smooth case. And I will give you the proof later, quick after a few comments, but I will give you the proof in the context of in a smooth case. So let me give just an application to the main theorem. So now I claim that under the assumption of the main theorem, there is a quasi-ital cover x1 of x, such that the decomposition, such that the tangent sheaf of x1 decomposes as the direct sum of the inverse image of G plus something else. And both are involutive subsheafs. Okay, so in particular, my G is now weakly regular. So why this is true? Let me just give you some hint. We have to check two. If you want to apply the criterion, you have to check a few things. First, the first is that the canonical map is an isomorphism. So in fact, this is easy for the normalization of a closure of a general leaf. So this is a general principle. And because the foliation has canonical singularities, this implies both this isomorphism, but this also implies that the normalization has canonical singularities. So in particular, this satisfies the assumption. This is a rational singularity. It's canonical as rational singularities. So the first one is okay. The second assumption is the assumption that the canonical class has to be Cartier. But in our theorem, the assumption is that the canonical class is only numerically trivial. But it turns out that for algebraically integrable foliations with canonical singularities and numerically trivial canonical class, the abundance holds. And this is a consequence of something called the canonical Bonnell formula. So this was proved by Ambro, say in a KLT case, extended by Floris in the low canonical case. But in fact, we only need the Ambro's result. So abundance holds. That means that in fact, in a setup of the main theorem, in fact, the canonical class is automatically torsion. So this explains this quasi-Eltham cover. The canonical class is torsion, so on some canonical cover, it becomes Cartier. So that we can apply the criterion. Okay. So let's go to the proof of the criterion. And as I said, suppose for simplicity that X is smooth and that L is a compact leaf. Okay, so let me go back just to the criterion. So if X is smooth and L is a compact leaf, so L has to be smooth, so it has rational singularities. This is well known. I mean, it is known that the canonical class of a leaf of a regular foliation is nothing but if the foliation is regular along the leaf, the tangent sheaf of the leaf is nothing but the restriction of the tangent sheaf of the foliation to the leaf. So in particular, taking determinant, you get this to be an isomorphism. So what I have to prove is just the existence of this decomposition. Let's see. Okay. So X is smooth and so J is regular along my compact leaf. So you take an ample class and you look at the function class of this ample divisor and you see it as a one class, so H1 over omega 1. And you also consider V to be the R vector defining G. So as usual, we take the determinant of G. Maybe you can forget about the twist by O of KG if you want. This is a flat line bundle by assumption. But you consider this V and you consider the contraction of omega to the R with this vector. This contraction gives you a nice class in HR of OX of KG. This cohomology group here. So recall that by assumption, this line bundle here is flat. And so there is a odd symmetry with coefficient in local system. You get R holomorphic form with value in OX minus K. Minus is for the symmetry. So now you have our form, you have R vector, and you can contract alpha along D, and what you get is a holomorphic function. And the point is to show that this function is non-zero. That is a holomorphic function on a compact manifold, so it is constant. And what we have to show that this is non-zero. Let's see why. Okay, so we have a commutative diagram. So here we have the contraction with D, so from our classes to this group here. And then since L is a leaf, the restriction of VL of V to the leaf is tangent to the leaf, for sure. So this induces, again, a similar contraction at the level of the leaf. And using the restriction map, the vertical map is just the restriction map, what you get is just a commutative diagram. Okay, so now, again, using the fact that our L is a leaf, we see that necessarily the map at the level of the sheaves here from omega r to ix of kj is in fact an isomorphism. This is our assumption on the adjunction formula I made in the statement in the singular locus. But here this is for free. This is an isomorphism. So this implies that this map, again, is an isomorphism. Okay, so you start with your omega to the R. This is a class here. You look at the image here. It has to be non-zero because H is an upper class. So it restricts to an upper class on L. So omega to the top is still non-zero. And this is an isomorphism. You get a non-zero class here. Okay, so this implies that the image here also is non-zero. So the image is the first contraction we started with. And this implies that alpha itself is non-zero because the contraction is non-zero. So the Hodge symmetric is non-zero as well. And again, the restriction to L is non-zero. So the restriction to L is just an R form with value in this flight line bundle that is non-zero. This is an R form on some variety of dimension R, since V to the L, VL, so V sub L, for instance, V sub L is also an R vector. When you do the contraction, you find something that is this non-zero at along L. So, and this proves that this alpha of A is non-zero as well. Okay, so in particular, this implies that this V is nowhere vanishing. So the assumption that V was just nowhere vanishing along the leaf now it implies that V is nowhere vanishing anywhere on X. So your foliation has to be regular. This was the first part of the criterion. And so the end of the proof is not difficult, but just you have to trust me. But you can use alpha to cook up a contraction. So you take the R minus one wedge product of G, you go into omega one. So that is this twist, but it doesn't matter, you can forget about it. So this is given by alpha. And the fact that alpha of V is nowhere vanishing implies that the composed map, so you look at the omega 1 to g star, so this is a quotient map, the composed map has to be an isomorphism. Okay, so this implies that the image here yields a splitting of the projection. This is exactly what you were looking for. So since I'm already out of time, maybe I skip the fact that this is involutive. This is easy to check. Okay, now, so far we know that so we started with a foliation with zero canonical class and canonical singularities, and we proved that more or less say that it is weakly regular. But we also know that it has algebraic leaves, and we like to understand what we can say for weakly regular foliation with algebraic leaves. And the first thing to do is to look at the corresponding case in a smooth version. So assume that X is a complex manifold, that G is regular foliation. Then you will see what happens in a singular case. So let's just start with even a more general statement. Just assume that there is a compact leaf, just one, not all. But assume that the Holomy group of this compact leaf is finite. So this is a classical theorem due to Red. The holomorphic version is due to Wang and Fiveg in 2008, but this is a classical theorem due to Red that in this setting, there is an analytic open neighborhood of your leaf, say U in X, that is saturated with respect to the foliation, and the projection onto a S mod G, where S is just transversal to the leaf, and equipped with the natural action of the Holomy group here, that satisfies the following property. There is an unramified cover, U tilde over U, and a smooth proper morphism onto S, such that the diagram is commutative, and such that if you pull back your foliation from U to U tilde, you get the foliation induced by the projection. So in particular, that tells you that there are infinitely many algebraic leaves, or compact leaves, say. And this gives you the local structure of the space of leaves here. And if you globalize the situation, so this is again due to Wang and Fiveg. So if you assume that X is a projective, and if you assume that G is algebraic integral, then in fact G is given by an equidimensional morphism with irreducible fibers onto a normal projective variety with quotient singularities. So this is the global picture of this thing. Okay. So this is what happens in a smooth case. A regular algebraically integrable foliation is given by a morphism. What we will see that a similar thing is true for weakly regular foliations. And the statement is a bit weaker, for sure. But it is as follows. So again, X is a normal complex projective variety with Q factorial KLT singularities. So I would like to avoid this Q factorial, but I don't know how. And J is a weakly regular algebraically integrable foliation on X. And I am assuming something more. I am assuming that J has canonical singularities. Then, as before, J is induced by a surjective equidimensional morphism psi from X to Y onto a normal projective variety. And moreover, I can prove that, in fact, there is a big open set in Y. So a big open set is just an open set with complementary of codimension at least two, such that all the fibers of psi over this open set are irreducible. So in a smooth case, all the fibers are irreducible. In a singular case, I'm only able to say this for over codimension one points of Y. And I will tell you later why. Oops. Okay, so let me just, this is not a proof, but just a sketch of proof, because this is just the geometric ideas of the proof. To show you how it works, you can check that the proof also works for the smooth case, and almost all the statements are almost obvious in the smooth case, but this is a bit more difficult in the singular case. So what we do, you consider the family of leaves. Okay, so this is a subvariety of Chow of X. It comes with a universal family Z contained in the product, say Y times X, and with two morphisms. So a morphism beta from Z to X, that is birational, and a vibration psi from Z to Y. And the property of this morphism psi is if you take a general point in Y, the fiber of psi maps to a leaf of the foliation in X. So this is what we call the family of leaves. So what we want to do is to prove that beta, in fact, is an isomorphism. By the very definition, this psi is already equidimensional. Now, the first thing to check is that the foliation here induced by psi, by the projection, is in fact also weakly regular. And moreover, as claimed in the statement of the theorem, there is a big open set in Y over which the singularities, the fibers, sorry, are irreducible. So the proof of the fact that the fiber are irreducible is as follows. It's in fact, so there is, you can have some control on the singularities of Z. I'm cheating a little bit, but suppose that Z is KLT, for instance. It is well known that KLT singularities are quotient singularities in codimension 2. Okay, but now we saw a few slides before that if you have a weakly regular foliation on a variety of quotient singularities, there is at most one separatrix that passes through any point. And this implies that the fibers have to be irreducible. Otherwise, at the intersection point, you have two separatrices passing through the point. So this is the reason why, where we get this irreducibility. Okay, so now we want to prove that beta is an isomorphism, so assume not. So there is some exceptional locus. And since X is Q factorial, this is the place where I use the Q factoriality, you have a prime divisor contained in X. So there are two possibilities for this prime divisor in the beta exceptional locus. So the first case is the case where E, your divisor, is horizontal with respect to psi. But then, if so, this implies that if you take a general point of the image of E in X, there are infinitely many separatrices passing through the point. But this contradicts the fact that G is canonical. I told you that McQuillan observed that if you are, in a surface case, but this is also true in this setting, through a canonical point, there are only infinitely many separatrices. Okay, so the assumption that G is canonical is used in particular here. Now, the second case is the case where E is vertical with respect to psi. And in this case, since the fibers are irreducible in codimension 1, E has to be saturated. So this is the inverse image and the psi of its image. now the claim is that B is invariant. Just let me just say something about this, because since X is assumed to be singular, it's not clear the meaning of being invariant. In a singular case, in a smooth case, this is obvious, but in a singular case, it's not obvious at all. But let me just rephrase this. What I mean is that, in fact, you have this foliation on E. It is induced by the projection. This is our assumption here. And I claim that this foliation is projectable under the map E to B. The meaning of this sentence is that there is a foliation of B on B of the same rank, with the property that if you start with a leaf here on E, so a fiber of psi, is mapped onto a leaf of the foliation on B. In particular, since the dimension of E is larger than the dimension of B, it follows that there are infinitely many fibers of C that are mapped to the same leaf in B. Infinitely many fibers of C mapped to the same leaf in B. But this is a contradiction to the fact that the morphism from Y to Cho is finite. By definition, this is the universal family. So this map is always finite. So this is a contradiction. So this shows that this beta has to be an isomorphism. And so we are done. Okay, so we are also almost done. So now I want to describe a little bit the proof of the main theorem. So let me just recall you the statement first. So X has KLT singularities, and G is an algebraically integrable foliation with canonical singularities and a numerically trivial canonical class. And I claim that this foliation is induced by a projection up to some quasi-etal core. This is what we want to prove. So far we have more or less proved that first that G is weakly regular, and that there is a decomposition of T sub X into a direct sum G plus E. So there is a supplementary of G in TX. And E also is involutive. I don't want to say too much on this, but one can easily reduce to the case where X is Q factorial, so that we can apply the previous theorem to conclude that, in fact, our G is also given by a morphism. Okay, so now the theorem is a question about morphisms. Recall also that there is a big open set where the fibers are irreducible. Now I will make another assumption. I am assuming that the fibers are more than irreducible. I am assuming that they are reduced. So this can be achieved by a finite by change. But unfortunately, this finite by change does not induce a quasi-etal cover of X, but only a finite cover. So there is something to do then at this point, but I want to skip this part of the proof. And to end the talk, I just want to assume for simplicity that the fiber are reduced in codimension. So what is the main consequence of this? The main consequence is that this E, so the direct sum of T sub X, in fact, induces a flat Ehrlichman connection on the morphism phi. The phi is a morphism that gives the foliation, okay? So you have an Ehrlichman connection, and this implies in particular that this morphism is locally trivial for the analytic topology. And say F is a typical fiber. So this is a very particular situation. It's easy to see that F is KLT and it has zero canonical class. This is the adjunction formula. So now we can use a singular version that is due to Kawamata of a theorem of Matsushima. So I learned this, the fact that it is a theorem of Matsushima, from the talk of Arnaud a few days ago. So the theorem of Kawamata says that if you have this F here with KLT singularities and zero canonical class, then there is a decomposition of a quasi-etal cover of F into a product of an abelian variety and G, which is a normal projective variety with a zero augmented irregularity. So we want to have the same thing on the total space, but already at the level of the fibers, this is the case. So now how to conclude the proof in this case. So recall that our fibration is locally trivial with typical fiber F. And the first thing to note is that we can recover the abelian part of the fiber just by looking at the automorphism group of the corresponding fiber, the connected component of the automorphism group. And it turns out that these algebraic groups fit together to define an abelian scheme over the base, why not? And by assumption, this abelian scheme is isotrivial. And it is well known that an isotrivial abelian scheme is trivial after a finite total base change. Using this remark, one can in fact split off an abelian factor to reduce the case where there is no global vector field. But then, since there is no global vector field, it's easy to see that the representation induced by the connection, in fact, is automatically finite. So again, after a quasi-total cover of the base, you have a product. But this is not a proof, but this is close to be a proof in this case. Thank you.